give you praise on this day.
Yes.
We lift up your holy name, God, because you are worthy. We come, Lord, for no other shape, form, or fashion, God, but to give you praise. But to let you know that, Lord, on this day, God, we give you thanks for the ways in which you have kept us. God, we come again, God, and as we stand here and worship God, again we say yes. Yes to your will. Yes to your way. Our soul says yes. God, be here now with the preacher. God, I pray that the words of my mouth and meditations of all of our heart would be acceptable in thy sight. For you, O Lord, are our strength. You are our redeemer. You are the rock on which we stand. And for that, O God, and for so much more, Lord, we say thank you. And we pray it all in the name of our Savior, Jesus the Christ. And let the people of God who love God say, amen. Amen. The text was read for you in your reading this morning. And it's from this letter of Philippians. Philippians 1, 3 through 11, which was read for you, and I'm going to read pieces throughout the sermon. And it's this text that comes from Paul to the church in Philippi. It is what I call Paul's love letter to the church. For this was a church in Philippi, unlike Corinth, who was dealing with all types of mess, that Paul didn't have time enough, or maybe didn't even want to say, I love you. But this was a church that where they were growing in grace. They had been growing in love. They had been growing in their giftedness with God. And Paul was pleased with the way in which they were letting the Lord use them for the purpose that they needed, that God had for them. And so he writes this letter to Philippi, and he can't wait until he tells them how much he is grateful for what the Lord is doing in their lives. So I pulled out for today this section of text, this verses 3 through 11, in which Paul, I believe, truly gives God both thanks and praise for this church in Philippi. Grateful for everything that God has been doing for them and also through them. In many regards, what this text that I pulled out is really the way in which I feel about Clair and my terms of leading. In fact, if I could just read this and sit down, I would. There might be some who might get a little dissatisfied with that. Amen. Amen. Zach, I'm pretty quick, right? And it's here in this text in Philippians where Paul begins. And really, Paul really lays out this sermon for me. I ain't really got to preach hard. Because he begins by saying, I thank my God every time I mention you in my prayers. He says, I am thankful for all of you every time I pray. And he said, it's always a prayer full of joy. I'm thankful for you.
Amen.
Every time I go to God in prayer, I am thankful and I am grateful that God has sent me to be able to pastor here at this church.
Amen.
That God had allowed it for me to be here for this time that I was here for. I'm grateful. Amen. Every time I go to God in prayer, that it can be a prayer of joy. That doesn't mean I'm always happy.
Well,
but it's a prayer that's filled with joy.
Yes, yes.
Because I have seen and God is showing me what he is doing and what he is going to do in the life of this church. Through the faithfulness of God's people who are here now and also of those who are yet to come. I am grateful, Claire. I'm grateful for the ways in which you walk on me and my family. And brought us here and been with us, seen the birth of my daughter, and helped us through this place. You've kept Caleb from trying to tear up this place. And banging them drums until his heart's desire. I'm grateful for that.
Yeah.
I'm grateful for you being able to listen to God, baby, and begin to trust. helps me a little to be able to do some things and navigate some places as we were going here through our lives. I'm grateful that you began to, that you were even listening to me. You weren't there just hear me. Everyone who has the ability to hear can hear. But you listen as well with your hearts and with your minds. And we began to live into this place and live into where I believe God was beginning to take us to. I'm grateful that you forgave me of my mistakes and the errors that I made and the times I misspoke and the times I spoke exactly what I wanted to say, but I shouldn't have said that. I'm grateful to you. I'm grateful for your faithfulness to God. There's one thing I can say, that that's one of the places that I praise God for you for, and I tell him even throughout the conference of the faithfulness of the people here at Clair UMC.
All right.
The faithfulness of the tradition of those who are here, from Ms. Grace Stewart and what the work she did in starting this congregation, to all the stories I've heard of those who have brought this congregation to where it was and have had the impact in this neighborhood. This church hasn't just been here as a place to come to and praise on Sunday, but lives have been transformed here. And it's because of, and it's through, your faithfulness. I'm grateful for the ways in which both of us have grown in grace and have grown in love throughout our time of being here together. I'm grateful for us catching on to the vision that God has laid claim to this place and for us beginning to live it out even more. You know, as I was here, I mentioned a little bit, I've heard the stories of the individuals who've come to this place and blessed this house and have brought it to be what it was. And I've heard the great stories of old and the great stories of the past. Heard the great histories and read the things and seen the pictures. And that was something that you all have always been proud of. But there were some who began to express that is our past going to be our greatest thing that God has for us.
Yeah, come on.
But as I've been here through this time, and it's not because of me, but it's because of God working in this place, I began to see a shift where we see that our latter years are going to be even greater than our present years. We see a shift where our past will not outshine what God has for us in the future. But what we are doing is building on the foundation that other folks have made and are now pressing forward toward the mark of the high calling that Jesus Christ has for us. And so I'm grateful that we caught on to the vision, that you joined me in special times of prayer and even times of fasting, trying to hear from God, what is it that you would have us to do in this place? I'm grateful for those who took the leap as we transitioned our leadership to a new place. I'm grateful for us embracing this theme of a real church for real people.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And not just embracing it that it sounds good and catchy, but living into what it means to be a relevant church, to be an enthusiastic church, to be an authentic church, and to be a loving church. And it's not because it was something that was brand new to you, because it's something that you had lived in through your history, and you now was committing to living into it through your future. I'm grateful for the conversations that we had about what God is doing both in your life personally and in the life of this church. I'm grateful that for the times that there were times when I pushed people and I pushed people maybe beyond their limits, beyond the tradition, and nobody cussed me out in person. I don't know what you did when you were home, but in person you didn't even cuss me out. And I'm grateful for that. Some who saw me coming. And I heard the chorus sprang up, I shall not be moved. So I just went on passion for that. The Lord's working on you, though. I'm grateful. I'm grateful for the work that you do each and every day, the way in which you serve this community through your food pantry, The way in which you serve the community, the hot meal lunches, the way in which you serve the community, where anybody who comes to the door, you welcome with open arms and say, how is it and what is it that we can do for you? I'm grateful. Paul says, I am thankful each and every time. And he says that I am glad because you have been my partners in the ministry. Mm-hmm. From the time you believe unto now, I'm grateful to have had partners in the ministry. That along my way, I was blessed and I was privileged enough to be able to say that I served here alongside of all of you all at Clair UMC. But Paul didn't just end there by being grateful for what God has done and for the people of God in Philippi, but he moved on and he said, I am sure about this.
Yeah, all right. Come on.
I believe it is in the King James or some other version said, I am persuaded that the one who began a good work in you will stay with you to complete the job. That the one who began these new things in your life, the one who began this refreshing and this reviving and this spiritual renewal in you will be with you to see the journey.
Yes.
I'm so glad that I don't need to be here to be able to declare that God is going to do something mighty because I know we serve a mighty God. I am sure and I am persuaded that God will complete whatever good work that God has started within you and within this church. I am persuaded that though you may have some tough days, and though as well you will have some better days and lurks between them, I believe that God will be able to see you through every situation. I believe that though some of us may deal with sicknesses, I know God to be a healer. I know that some of us will deal with situations and with trials in life. I know God to be one who can bring us out of everything. There's no monk or bar, there's no pit, there's no thing that's too deep, no mountain high, no water wide. I think that somebody said, where God cannot bring us through. I'm sure and I am persuaded that God is one who takes care. And as I was even struggling with my own sense of leaving this place, place that I came to love dearly, I began to remember that God calls us for certain times and for certain seasons, and to deliver a certain message and for us to then move on. I began to think about a certain person in scripture whom I love. We talked about a little bit in Bible study. His name is Agabus. A lot of folks may not know anything about Agabus because he only shows up twice and he only takes up four verses in his whole two times of showing up. But Agabus was a prophet. He shows up in the book of Acts two times. Once he comes with a group of prophets and he delivers this prophecy that there's going to be a famine in the land. He stands up, gives this prophecy, and he sits down. There's another place later on in chapter 21, I believe it is, where he comes to Paul and he ties and binds Paul up and he says, Paul, someone is going to capture you and this is exactly how they're going to tie you up. He delivers the message to Paul and he goes back home to be about his business. I realized in looking at Agabus that there are times where God calls us to deliver a message. That God calls us to go for a season and to fulfill an assignment, but then it's time for us to move on. Because if we don't move on, we're getting God's way. If we don't press on to the next thing that God is calling us to do, the next assignment, we're getting away of what God is trying to do to the people whom we just ministered to. And so I realized that we got to move on sometimes and get out of the way so that God can make a way. That we have to move out of the way so we can see what God is about to do sometimes through us and maybe through whoever might be coming next. Mm-hmm. Call him. Deliver a message and then move. Paul tells his church, I am persuaded. And then he says, I have good reason to think this way about all of you because I keep you in my heart.
Well, all right.
He has good reason to think of this because I keep you in my heart.
Yeah.
Because I continually keep you lifted up in prayer.
Yeah.
I believe that God's going to work it out.
Yes.
Because I continually fast and pray on your behalf and study the scriptures and send letters of encouragement to you, I have reason to believe and be persuaded of this.
Yes.
Because I've seen the way God has brought me through many situations and transitions, I've been persuaded that God will do the same for you. Not only is he persuaded, but he also says, I'm praying for you.
Yeah.
He also says, I'm praying for you. Verse 9 in the Common English Bible says, this is my prayer, that your love might become even more and more rich with knowledge and all kinds of insight. I pray this so that you will be able to decide what really matters. So you will be sincere and blameless on the day of Christ. I pray that you will then be filled with the fruit of righteousness, which comes from Jesus Christ. Paul's prayer for the Philippian church is that God will give them an overflowing love that is capable of discerning what really matters. God will give them a love and a grace that's so strong that they are quit doing the things that don't matter.
Go ahead.
And my prayer for you, because I'm praying for you as I leave this place and as I even am gone, I will continue to pray. And it's going to be prayer that your faith will continue to be strengthened.
Amen.
In the ways in which your prayer, in the ways in which your faith is strengthened, is by prayer and study.
Yep.
It's by taking times away to remove yourself from a meal, maybe from a certain situation, so you can fast and pray and tarry with God to hear what God is trying to take you to. But not only that your faith is strengthened, but I pray that you will be encouraged. Encouraged to know that God has not finished with you yet. That if you have life and movement of limbs in your body, God has not finished with you yet. I pray that God will give you an overflow of love. And that by that overflow of love, you will then be able to discern what really matters. And to quit the things that don't matter.
Yeah.
To quit the things that don't glorify God.
Yes.
To stop the things that aren't taking us to the next level.
Amen.
My prayer is that you fall even more deeper in love with God.
Yes.
That you might be able to know and to journey with God and have a relationship with God. It's beyond just some superficial sin, but that you have a true relationship with God that's rooted in the heart of God. Most of all, I pray that you will be led by God.
Yes.
That everything you do in your life will be because as a direct result of the way in which God is leading you.
Yes.
I pray that God will lead you towards the future. I pray and I believe that God is taking you to the next step. This isn't a goodbye. This isn't a things are over. This is a sense that God is taking us both to the next place where we need to go. And there are times in which we need to move on in order to move up. There are times where we need to part ways in order that God might be able to birth new life within us. And so I am grateful for God who's able to keep us both and increase us both, even when we are going into different places. I'm grateful for I'm grateful to God today, church. And I pray that as I continue to pray for you, that you also pray for me.
Yes, sir.
And hold me and I and my family in prayer.
Yes.
Knowing with pure faithfulness that God is carrying us.
Yes.
And taking us to the next place. We will go in the grace of God, in the love of God, and in the peace of God that keeps us each and every day. I love you. Amen.